38 for four. The follow-on target has still not been achieved. That's 297. And the batsman out today, Chris Smith, Court Smith, bowled Cairns for 91. And then Alan Lamb, LBW to Cairns for 49. At the end, Derek Randall there on 54 not out. He's been there just under 3 hours. And with him, the night watchman, Bob Taylor, not out yet to score. So, as I mentioned before, not what you'd call a scintillating day's cricket. Let's now go to the New Zealand bowling figures. Lance Cairns, the most successful of the New Zealand bowlers, 2 for 24 off 25 over. And wicketkeeper Bob Taylor, who had yet to score. We join the action now in the first over of the day. It's Lance Cairns bowling to Bob Taylor.
And a half-hearted appeal from Cairns. Just wrapping Bob Taylor on the pads. Yet to get off the mark, but going down the leg side. And this one going through, and very fortunate not to play it on. Got an inside edge onto his pad, and it went by the off stump, or perhaps just a little over.
Let's have a look at that in swing from Lance Cairns again. Really going there, through bat and pad, and dropping well short of Ainsmith behind the stumps.
And a loud appeal for LBW.
Out, over.
Not getting very far forward, and so end of the over, 238 for four. And that one just not bouncing at all. Bounced twice, in fact, before it got through to the keeper, Smith.
Yes, that one pitched and went almost all along the ground. Let's have a look at the bounce, if there was any. But it wasn't all that far from his off stump, cut back a bit.
That's a more forceful shot from Bob Taylor. He'll get a couple of runs for the shot. Edgar in pursuit. And so that's two Bob Taylor. He gets off the mark, in fact, with that shot.
After 25 minutes.
Yes, that's not a bad shot at all. Didn't put a great deal of power into it, but the ball went very quickly. He must have a good bat there, Bob Taylor. Have a look. Just pushes it forward, and the ball really traveled quickly.
Rawn beaten outside the off stump. This one left him off the pitch and a little quicker. Cairns varying his pace nicely here.
Yes, Bob Taylor not perhaps good enough to be playing that stroke so early in the innings. Just trying to open up his shoulders, not making any contact. And that's the man, Cairns, who started to bowl his in-swingers again, and occasionally he's moving the ball away from the bat. It's Cairns to Taylor. Down, kept low, loud appeal. Not from Cairns, though.
And keeping a little low, there'll be a single here for Randall as he plays it behind square. So he goes on to 57, a total up to 243. And this is just a fine edge down the leg side. It could well beat Bock. In fact, it does. It goes for four runs. So just a fine edge down the leg side brings four for Randall, and he goes on to 61. Leg spin, a loud appeal for an LBW here from Cairns and those behind the stumps. And Cairns looks in disbelief.
Let's have a look at that slower delivery. Randall coming forward.
At least one here as it goes past Jerry Coney. Just a single, so Randall's on to 62.
And Randall, let's have a look at those arms and the extension of the arms in the bat. So easily done.
Short and well hit by Bob Taylor. Appeal for an LBW as Randall overbalanced coming forward into that shot.
Down again and getting rather too close, giving himself room, getting outside leg stump to free his arms. Going down the wicket and a bad shot from Taylor. I've seen him hit straight and well. but he really slogged across the line, managed to get it out behind square leg.
Yes, Taylor going down the wicket, looking first of all to hit it straight and then finding he's not there and just pulling right across the line. And if he misses that, he runs the risk of a bowled or a stumping.
Going down, and that wasn't a good shot. He'll take four. But once again, Randall going down and looking as though he was going to hit it straight, and then once again hitting across the line. Smith at the ready behind the stumps. Down again, and yes, is he stumped? In fact, he is. His first stumping in Test cricket. And certainly the way the batsmen were charging, he was going to have every chance if they missed it. And so the fifth England wicket goes down with a score of 284. That of Bob Taylor for 23.
Well, I didn't think we'd see it, the ball after we'd just commented on it, but there you see he's not covering the flight of the ball. He's just trying to hit it in the leg side and leaves the wickets exposed. It misses the wickets, but Ian Smith has plenty of time to stump Taylor.
See how Smith taking it well there, and he's and Bob Taylor's miles out. Bock to Botham. And looking for a single, and Randall screaming no, turning it a chance of getting Botham off the mark, and wisely so.
Derek Randall. Oh, a good delivery. Randall playing forward, the ball seemed to leave him a little.
Here's an illustration of how Martin Crowe, as he beats the outside edge of Derek Randall's bat, how he's very capable of producing a very, very good ball. And this makes him a useful change bowler and a useful partnership breaker.
Oh, a good delivery. And Ian Botham so close to getting an edge on that one.
Ball leaving Ian Botham on a lovely length.
And he gets a bouncer, albeit a friendly one, which he's not overly interested in. So that's lunch on the fifth and final day of the third Rothmans Test here at Eaton Park in Auckland. And England go to lunch at 291 for the loss of five. Beginning the morning at 238 for four. Bob Taylor, the only man out. Stump Smith, Bob Bock for 23. Botham is four not out. Derek Randall still 21 runs short of that 100, which no doubt he'll be working his way to this afternoon. He's 79.
And it's Stephen Bock bowling the first ball after lunch to Randall. Looks as though he gets a nick on it and then onto his pad around the corner for a single. Charging, hitting it away over extra cover, into the stand, six runs for Ian Botham. And so he goes from 5 to 11 with that hit. It's Crowe. Oh, good shot by Randall. This could well be four runs just in front of square. It is, and so Randall on to 86.
Which means that he's the first player in this tour to get 500 first-class runs. And unless Botham gets 193, he'll be the only one.
That's a strong shot through the covers, not even having to move. He punished this just wide of Chatfield's left hand. And Randall once again yelling rags at himself. He got caught there, deciding, didn't know whether to play forward or back. In the end, he got caught on the crease, not making a positive movement. He's quite angry with himself. 98th over with the second new ball, Stephen Bock to Randall. Driving through the covers, that's four. Split between mid-off and extra cover. Good strong shot going down to meet the ball, and so Randall goes on to 97.
This particular ball that they're using is into its 99th over. So New Zealand can have a new one any time they want. By Martin Crowe. Good line, good length. Derek Randall already with a century in the series, 164 at the Basin Reserve in Wellington. Had a first ball and a top score in the Christchurch loss. Lapping this one, just one run. Martin Crowe coming in off the fence at backward square leg. So Randall is 99, 3-3-4 for 5. Four boundaries and a 6 so far for Ian Botham in his 31 runs. This time it's on the leg side and hit high, wide and handsome over square leg for 6. Botham is 37. And England moved to 3:45 for 5.
Well, that really is high class entertaining stuff. Swinging the bat strongly.
Another powerful drive this time. It's almost a thick outside edge. Bock giving chase, but it's 4. In both into 41. 3:49 for 5 is the England score. 14 runs off the over so far. Short and hooked, and that's going to be 4 more through mid-wicket. That's 18 runs off the over. England's 350 is up. 3:53 for 5. And Ian Botham is 45. Randall on 99, facing Stephen Bock. And Botham's going to go through for a single. Randall is home. There's no signal from the umpire. That's Derek Randall's 100. Derek Randall's 7th Test century. And congratulated by his England teammate Ian Botham. Randall's 2nd century in this series. Just flicking it round the corner. Botham calling him through from the non-striker's end.
There's a new delivery, a new ball.
Well, if you want to get the shine off the new ball in a hurry, there's one of the best ways I know. Short outside the off stump, and Ian Botham cuts it to the boundary for 4. Ian Botham is 50, England at 3:59 for 5. And again, this time Bock makes a valiant attempt to field it. Bruce Edgar's giving chase from cover, but it's 4 more. Botham 54, 3:63 for 5. High in the air over mid-off. One bounce and 4 more into the number 4 stand. Sean is going off this new ball very quickly with those blows from Ian Botham. He's 58, it's 3:67 for 5. And Randall is out. It's a good catch by John Wright at point. Randall is out for 104. England are 371 for 6.
It's the ball, the outswing. Randall not coming into it, just standing there and playing with the swing, hitting the ball in the air. And very nicely caught at point by Crowe.
Botham facing Hadley. Oh, and that's dropped at first slip by Jeff Crowe. The outside edge running from Botham's bat in the air to the right hand of Jeff Crowe at first slip, but he put it on the grass.
Very, very high class delivery by Hadley. Pitching, cutting away, takes the outside edge, and Jeff Crowe unable to hold the catch.
And Richard Hadley putting in a very steady performance here. 33.2 overs, 8 maidens, and 1 for 75. And of course, it was Hadley's first ball in his spell that he took the wicket of Fowler. Seems a long time ago now. And the last 50 came up in just 30 minutes. Easily the fastest 50 in the match.
Came off 9 overs and 1 ball.
Thank you, Bill.
And he's edged it between first and second slip, and that was a definite chance. It went fairly quickly, particularly off this pitch, but neither Crow nor Coney being able to latch onto it.
There, Mark's playing away from his body to a shortish delivery.
And edged behind and is out. Mark's stretching away from his body. And Chatfield, good to see Charlie Chatfield coming to light here, picking up his second wicket. And so the seventh England wicket now has fallen with the score at 387. That of Mark's for six.
Again, as he did in the previous overs, you see the huge gap between bat and pad, stretching way out to the offside, getting a thick outside edge, and Ian Smith taking a very good catch.
And there's a loud appeal for an LBW. It kept low. And that looked like a good shout. It'll be really worth seeing it on replay. Hadley obviously disappointed.
Well, any bowler in the world would certainly ask for that one.
And noticing that Foster has got a different type of helmet on, one with the bars. And that's a good take off the pad down the leg side there by Ian Smith.
Oh, what a great series Ian Smith's been having. And there, a beautiful one-handed take down the leg side. Very much more subdued, Ian Botham, than we saw in the post-lunch period.
That's when the ball was very old, though. That was the second ball of the innings. Once the new ball arrived, he hit the first three balls before him, and he's quietened down pretty much since. Oh, and he very nearly dragged that one back onto his stumps. Looking for the big shot through the offside, inside edge, onto his boot.
Yes, a big swing, and he doesn't get his feet across at all, which means that the bat's not in the right position to take advantage of that wide-ish ball from Hadley, and jams down on it on the bottom edge.
Opens on 70, facing Richard Hadley. That's a fine shot. Lovely piece of fielding by Coney, and Botham will be run out. Foster did not respond to Botham's call. Botham kept going. Jeremy Coney made a marvellous stop at cover. Threw the ball back to Smith, and Botham was stranded in the middle of the pitch, and that's a sad way for a five innings from Ian Botham to come to an end.
Well, what a great piece of cricket. There's Botham hitting it like a tracer bullet. Into the covers. Coney's diving. He's still alert, head up. Arm in a position to throw it. A lovely throw back to Smith, still lying on the ground. Botham giving Foster a bit of a glare there, but a magnificent piece of fielding. And that's the end of Botham. From another angle, into the covers she goes. Jeremy Coney, hand on it straight away, and a lovely return to Ian Smith.
Richard Hadley cannot believe that that was not given out LBW.
Well, we can only assume that that pitch is outside off, and with Bob Willis playing a shot, that is the reason umpire Woodward turns down the appeal. But Richard Hadley very keen on that one.
It's an appeal for a catch behind, and this time Hadley has got his wickets. Bob Willis didn't like the decision. Ian Smith takes another catch. Richard Hadley has got his second wicket of the innings. Willis is out for three. It's 396 for nine.
Just pitching outside off stump. Willis to, oh, closing the face of the bat. There's a loud appeal from the slip cordon. Smith and Hadley. Umpire Woodward gives him out. Bob Willis stares back down the wicket in disbelief.
Cowans gets himself off the mark here.
fact, Chatfield has to work very hard to prevent a four. In the end, he just gives it a little assistance through his foot. That's the English 400, 401 for nine, and Norman Cowans gets four.
So that's Neil Foster on strike. He hasn't had much of the strike recently. He's on one. Hadley the bowler. It's a short ball and it's pulled away around the leg side. In fact, he's pulled it away quite nicely, square of the wicket, and that's four runs to Foster.
That was actually a very good shot from Foster. He saw the ball dug in short, up on his toes, and over the top of it, got it off the middle of the bat.
Bopped to Foster. And Foster going for a drive in the air, over Stirling at mid-off, and that's four runs. Oh, and perhaps that was a misstumping as Foster jumps down the track to try and hit Bock in the air over the leg side, and it runs away for a couple of byes.
That was the first, I think one can say, first major error of Ian Smith behind the stumps. Just couldn't take the ball cleanly. It's a difficult take, but as a top-class keeper, he should have been able to manage that.
Chatfield to Cowans. And Cowans, a lovely off-drive, just wide of the outstretched foot of Chatfield, and that's a beautiful shot for four.
That's a good straight drive by young Cowans.
Bock to Foster, and he goes for a big hit over the widest mid-on area. And that's six.
That's his first six in Test cricket.
That's a good blow by Foster. Going down the pitch, hitting it slightly against the spin.
Pony to Cowans. And that's a googly. And Cowans launches into it. He hits it high over mid-off. Four more runs.
Have a look at that swing. Hammers it.
Box to Cowans. There's an appeal for a catch. It's out. That's the end of the English innings. Lance Cairns from Silly Point catching Norman Cowans' back pad off Stephen Bock. And England are all out for 439.
And that's Bock getting another wicket in this test match, getting Cowans to come forward, bat and pad, and Lance Cairns is there. Right hand job, quite happy, end of the England innings.
So the England innings finally came to an end at just on 5 o'clock on the fifth and final day, a massive 227 overs and three balls. The last man out, Norman Cowans, caught Cairns bowled Bock for 21, and England all out for 439. And of academic interest, I suppose, is the fact that England trailed New Zealand on the first innings by 57 runs. In total, seven bowlers used by Geoffrey Howarth, the New Zealand captain, but certainly his four regulars did most of the work. Hadley, Cairns, Bock and Chatfield all bowling over 40 overs. Stephen Bock getting through 61 overs and three balls of left-arm spin, 28 maidens. He finished up as the most successful bowler, 3 for 103. Ewan Chatfield, 2 for 72, conceding less than two runs per over. And Richard Hadley and Lance Cairns also turning in very steady marathon performances. Well, New Zealand came into bat at 10 past five on the fifth and final afternoon, and John Wright and Bruce Edgar batted through comfortably enough against Willis and Cowans' two stumps at 5:30. John Wright was 11 not out, and Bruce Edgar had yet to score. There were five extras, and New Zealand finished at 16 without loss. So when stumps were drawn at 5:30, New Zealand led by 73 runs with 10 second innings wickets in hand, but that was the end of the match, so it was a draw and a win to New Zealand by 1-0 in the series. Certainly an historic moment in New Zealand. And after the game, I spoke to the New Zealand captain, Geoffrey Howarth. It's been a fantastic 5 years for you as the New Zealand captain. You began by winning against the West Indies back in 1980, but would this perhaps be the highlight of all?
Well, like you said, there's been one or two highlights, and they're very hard to distinguish, but obviously the first time to beat England in a test series is quite a, it'll probably sink in a couple of days' time or a couple of months' time, but it's very pleasing to beat them, especially after we did reasonably well in England and unfortunately sort of lost our way a bit in the third and fourth test in England. And so it's nice to come back and with confidence play and I think convincingly beat them in this test series.
Yes, we talked in Christchurch about the fact that New Zealand has sort of let the advantage slip in the last couple of years against Australia and in England. It was very obvious to people watching here that you were determined not to let the advantage slip in 1984.
Yes, well, that's what we, I think, the couple of months after the lads got home after England to sit down and think about why perhaps that we did let ourselves down to a certain extent in England and to get thinking a bit more positively about the series that we've just had, and I think they did do that, and they've played with confidence. They've played as a very good unit, and we've thought about the game a lot more perhaps than what we did in England, and we've stuck to a pattern in bowling and found ourselves coming out on top, so we can't ask much more than that, except perhaps continued more test series victories in the future.
A very happy New Zealand captain, Geoffrey Howarth, in a very jubilant New Zealand dressing room after the match. And we must say at this time that Bob Willis, the England captain tonight, left the ground pretty early, obviously off to celebrate the New Zealand victory with the New Zealand team, because in fact these two teams have got on so very well on a social basis over the last couple of years, and I'm sure Willis will be joining in the celebrations with the team. So with Bob Willis unable to speak to us after the game, I was able to talk to a former Test player and the assistant manager of this England touring team, Norman Gifford. Norman, I suppose it goes without saying that your party is pretty disappointed that the way things have turned out here.
Yes, that would be true. Yes, we're disappointed that we've lost the series 1-0, but we've got to get from here now down to Christchurch, and we've got to pick things up and look to win the one-day series.
As far as this test match was concerned, looking at the pitch and the way it's even playing now after 5 days, was there ever a realistic chance of a result here?
I think when we came to Auckland that we always knew that it would be difficult to ball any side out twice in this test match. When we played a three-day game here, the wicket was basically the same as it had been in this test match. We picked five ballers knowing that our work would be, you know, a hard job for us to win the match. But with the weather and the New Zealanders have batted well, we've batted well. The bowlers have toiled for 5 days, really.
So the series was won and lost on the first day at Christchurch, is that fair comment?
I think that's fair comment, yes. We would be bitterly disappointed in the way we performed on the first day at Christchurch. We should have bowled, I think, New Zealand out for around about 150. But we didn't bowl well enough, and if you don't bowl well enough on the first day when a wicket is going to deteriorate, then you pay the price, and we paid dearly.
The England assistant manager, Norman Gifford. Well, New Zealand won the series by 1-0, certainly an historic moment for New Zealand cricket. The man of the match, the New Zealand wicketkeeper Ian Smith, with his maiden test century and equaling the New Zealand test record of 5 dismissals in a match. That's the test series. Now we look forward to the 3 Rothmans Cup one-day internationals. The first of those is on at Lancaster Park in Christchurch this coming Saturday, so we'll have highlights for that match for you on Saturday night. Good night.